So Twitter's going public and selling stock. I mean, how much of a difference could that possibly make? Actually, I've been meaning to do a little tweet about Breaking Bad. Let me just check my feed.
Please deposit 25 cents for the first 140 characters.
Oh, come on. They're ruining one of the great frontiers of free social media. Okay. Hate this. Twitter used to be crazy fun, and now it's like everything else. Just a servant to mammon, a money-grubbing dungeon polished up to look like a bright, shiny apple.
Our voice recognition software has converted your rant into a tweet and sent it out. You will automatically be billed $4.75.
Oh, hell no! There, it's dead. Die, you spawn of Satan! I'm sorry you had to hear that. On today's news, twilight of the pervy politicians, the folly of spin-offs, and Putin invading the op-ed page. And now he plays old Mr. Spanky in the 50 Shades of Grey spin-off. Colin McEnroe.
Yeah, we're doing it as a sitcom, actually. I can't say much more about it. All right, so welcome to the nose. Let me tell you who's here, and then we'll tell you a little bit about what we're going to be talking about today. Jim Chapdelain, musician, producer, extraordinaire in every possible other way as well. Making her debut, I wish we had like trumpets or something like this, or a drum roll or something along those lines. Making her nose debut, and possibly her nose swan song as well. we'll see how she likes it. Melini Kintaya is here with us. She's an actor and writer living in Brooklyn, New York. What's she doing here on the nose? Well, she, and we should especially mention, and we will mention many times, her book, or maybe she'll mention her book. What we'll mention right now is that tonight, at the Kyone Wolf hosted storytelling session, The Mouth, at the Mark Twain House, she will be the featured storyteller among many other storytellers. The theme is luck and serendipity. It is at the Mark Twain House. It's at 7:30. You can get in for a measly $5. Also joining us from Trinity College, Luis Figueroa. I have no idea where he's appearing tonight, but he'll be DJing on Saturday night. He's from professor from Trinity College. I should say that part, definitely. Okay, so here's what we're going to talk about. Here in the first segment, we're going to sort of spin off a couple of different ways, you should pardon the use of the term spin off, from the New York elections. First, talk about the fact that four different candidates in this primary, four different candidates who had various, so we say, sexual blots on their escutcheons, fell. They did not triumph. Well, we'll mention who they are and sort of try to figure out whether that means anything or not. We figured since we had a New Yorker here, we should be a little New York-oriented. And if we have time, I'd also like to sort of talk a little bit about New York post-Bloomberg. There's a lot of soul-searching about this city and whether during Bloomberg's time it became even more sanitized, more for the rich, less the authentic and sometimes enjoyably pervy place that it used to be. In the second segment, we are going to talk about spinoffs, real spinoffs, actual spinoffs. There's going to be a spinoff called Better Call Saul from the series Breaking Bad. I think it might be an interesting thing just to talk briefly about the wisdom or folly of spinoffs. And then lastly, if we have time, we will just absolutely make sure we have time. Vladimir Putin made his way to the op-ed page of the New York Times this week. Rumor is he also won the cartoon caption contest in The New Yorker, but it's not, yeah. not sure.
The guy coming through the window?
Hasn't been announced officially yet. But he's on the op-ed page. And a little controversial even just having him there on the op-ed page, making his case, lecturing America about American exceptionalism. Of course, some people thought he made more sense than most people on the op-ed page of The New York Times. So we'll try to get to that as well. So let's start, though, with this election. And some of the names need no introduction. Anthony Weiner, as you know, came in basically last with a very measly percentage. And it's the second time I've used the word measly today. And, of course, Elliot Spitzer also did not win in his race for comptroller. Some less well-known people, Vito G. Lopez, running for councilman. He was a staffer fondler, I think it's fair to say. We could go into sordid details about it, but you don't need to hear them. He was, anyway, been accused of being a fondler of his employees and staffers. And then Micah Kellner, whose offense was probably a little bit, first of all, it was 4 years old, and but supposedly he he sort of like did dirty online Scrabble. I don't know all the details of this. I don't want to know all the details, but he was doing online Scrabble with somebody.
With friends.
Yeah, who worked with his, worked in his office, and he did things that were inappropriate, both for Scrabble and for interactions with your coworkers, and that came back to haunt him. He also did not prevail. So, so since Melina Quintana is making her debut here, and since she lives in Brooklyn, I mean, I don't know. Should we conclude from this that New York is become especially prudish about these kinds of things?
I don't think we're becoming prudish by any stretch of the imagination. I think we're just sick of it. Mm-hmm. And it seems that our state has just, you know, you get one Mark Sanford, but we got a lot all at once. And everyone seemed to be running again, and we call him Vito Gropez in New York. And it was just too much. And when your Facebook, you know, news feed is full of comedians saying enough already, they don't even want the material anymore. You know, it's just so ridiculous. And there's in saying, you know, we want to hear about the issues. We want to hear about what's going on, because things are, we're going to get to post Bloomberg New York later, but things are kind of rough for the middle class. Now it's not as a city of opportunity the way it used to be, or climbing up the ladder, or neither is America for that reason. That's a whole nother show. But and I think we're just sick of it, and we don't want to give someone another chance, because and I think Weiner actually his light kind of ruined it for everyone else. I think people were thinking, well, if he's going to do it again, well, is Spitzer going to do this again? Do we have to keep dealing with this in the news when we have some real issues and problems and things we need to talk about?
We also want to hear from you about this as we go along. 860-275-7266. 860-275-7266. But you make a great point. Maybe the news is not that these guys all lost, but that all of them actually thought that they could compete for re-election with what they had on their record. Although, Jim, one of the things that you did, you sent us a one link as we were all emailing frantically around about this, sort of ranking and trying to codify or develop a taxonomy for sex scandals. And maybe part of the question is, like, who's it's hard to believe that Mark Sanford's sex scandal isn't as bad or worse than these guys, though.
You know, there's a cultural thing. I mean, maybe New York, like, it was just saturated with perviness, and they're done with it. And just the omnipresence of all these guys. Whereas Mark Sanford actually went to Argentina. So he was out of our face, and somehow he got reelected. And I think maybe in the South, as long as you're a serial monogamist like Newt Gingrich or Mark Sanford, it's cool.
Yeah.
But if you're actually using digital media, now that's a whole new kind of pervy. I kind of broke it into three kinds of perviness, which would be institutionalized old white guy entitled perviness like Filner. Standard caught in an investigation of your own making, like Spitzer, and then modern digital super creepy pervy guy with minoxidil and Rogaine, like Weiner, who has invented a whole, you know, fell into a whole new kind of pervy trap.
Comedy gold.
But you did some hard work on this. That's very impressive. Yeah.
I think another thing about Weiner that was upsetting to me personally was. He would go on public radio in New York. He'd go, it's a private matter. It's a private matter. It's a private matter. And I kept, like, wanting to say, do you not know how Twitter works? What is private about Twitter? You didn't have enough
thought it was private.
I think he did initially think it was private.
But, you know, Louisa, I sort of initially, at the end of the 90s, I sort of thought, well, I mean, the rules really did change a little bit, maybe. And some of these things are starting to be regarded as private matters. And we know that Bill Clinton, whose private matters became very, very public, could have been elected to a third term. I mean, really, ultimately, it wasn't that big a problem for him anymore. So, I mean, I'm kind of... Like, what happened this time around, you know?
Well, I think, first of all, for the audience, just to clarify, my real name is Luis Figueroa. It is not Carlos Danger. So I don't invent names like that. I mean, I don't understand why people have to pick up on Latino names in order to have, like, these kind of identities.
Well, wouldn't it be Carlos Peligroso?
Or like, Carlos Peligroso.
If you would like to invent a name for Luis, text, you could tweet us. Don't sext us. Yes. You can tweet us at WNPR Colin. Yes, if you have a new name for Luis, at WNPR Colin. Continue.
So, first of all, I think that I tried to do a little bit of an exercise in a conversation last night along the lines that Jim did now of classifying these kinds of situations. And then the question came up was the following. All right, so for us as the public, what is worse? The person that had an affair, that fell in love with somebody, left the person that we're with, and then they moved on. Sanford, right? Or the person that is tweeting geographical aspects of their bodies. So
specifically Southern Hemisphere.
So interesting, the conversation that I had is, for a lot of people, is no. The person that is sending this picture, that is the creepiest one. But what if that person is your partner? Which one will you tolerate less? The one that had the affair, the real affair with somebody, or the one who was just sending these Twitter messages? So it depends on the angle that you look at it.
I wish we had a sound effect now.
The psychology.
I'm so glad we don't.
Yeah, the psychology of it is different if you're the public as opposed to the person involved with the individual that is doing these kinds of things. Now, my other quick initial comment is in response to what Amina was saying, we might say New York politics up to July 23rd, 2013, and afterwards when it comes to these issues. Because if you look, at least I was trying to follow a little bit of the news reports from New York, and Weiner was doing very well in the polling. Spitzer was ahead. Hmm. Sometimes in the spring or the earlier in the summer, first half of the summer, it was like, wow, these people are going to make a comeback. This is incredible. Let's try to explain why these people are supported. And then there were these reports about minority support for Weiner was very substantial, and I was trying to make sense of that. July 23rd, Carlos Danger comes into play, and everybody, I think that's the moment when people got sick of it. And I think that one psychological aspect of it, too, is the character of his wife. Mm-hmm. It's an angle that I'd like to talk about later.
Well, another part of that, in his case, was that his behavior started to deteriorate in other ways. He started flipping out in public situations.
Literally flipping. He exited with a Johnny Cash bird, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yes. Melanie, one of the things that you were saying, I think that I heard in what you were saying is, maybe in some ways it's a mistake to look at all this wonderful quartet as a quartet. I mean, they're all individual stories in certain ways. And to a certain degree, New Yorkers maybe were just saying, we really want to have like a really good mayor. And
I
a really good councilman.
Yeah, and I think Stringer won as his policies. Mm-hmm. It was close. It was close. I think one thing that I went through with Spitzer, and I voted for Spitzer initially.
And he might have been a good comptroller too, you know?
Right, but when I voted for him for governor, it was at a time where we needed someone in New York like Spitzer. Mm-hmm. And we, the good people of the state of New York, sent you to go do a job. We hired you, and you have failed on that job. And I feel like we felt like that with Weiner, where we might have actually liked his policies initially. Mm-hmm. But then we don't have time for this. If you work for us, you belong to us, you are our employee, you're there to represent us, and you're not living up to your job if we're being distracted by this, that, and the other thing. But going back to an earlier point, I actually think someone like Gropez or Filner is the worst, because I feel like there's a victim there to mm-hmm. that harassment. There's someone that wants to keep their job yet is being groped at their workplace, which is...
We should be clear. Bob Filner, who we've alluded to a couple of times but haven't really sort of described, Bob mm-hmm. Filner, of course, the erstwhile mayor of San Diego, who became famous for what is known as the Filner headlock, where he would grab you in a certain way and smooch you or try to thrust himself upon you in an unwanted way.
And that went on for like 22 years or something.
Well, actually the analog, you and I might be the only two people here old enough to remember it, but there was a guy named Bob Packwood in the U.S. Senate who kind of did a similar thing.
That was back in the 80s.
Yeah. Bob Packwood was like the precursor.
Way back.
Precursor of the...
That's why I arrived in this country.
The Filner headlock was Bob Packwood, who did kind of the same thing. He would just sort of grab women and thrust his Packwoodian tongue into their mouths, and he just sort of thought, one out of 10 times it'll lead to something.
It's starting to sound like Game of Thrones.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So this kind of thing has been around for a while.
And neither is it endemic to just New York. I think in New York you have like the perfect storm of this sort of bubbling up, but it's everywhere, and it is institutionalized. But with politicians, because theoretically we're paying them to do a job and they're making decisions on our behalf, when they make decisions like this, it there's an impact that's different than if Mel Gibson goes crazy. We just cannot go see his movies if
Absolutely.
We want.
Although I'd like to point out, we don't have, for the most part, political sex scandals in Connecticut. We tend to have economic scandals.
Phil Giordano.
Phil Giordano would be the I don't even know if you call that a skeptic. I mean, he's just like a criminal from outer space.
Right,
but,
right.
But it's not, you know, I don't know whether there's something in the drinking water here.
Land of steady habits.
You know,
what is in this
drinking
water?
I think it's a Puritan heritage.
It could be our Puritan,
Puritan heritage. Yes.
Well, you know, I also want to talk a little bit, too, about because not only is this sort of a time for thinking about certain people who got elected and certain people who didn't, although maybe while we're talking about that, too, I think it's the other thing that's fascinating to me about this is that the kinds of issues that might have come up 10 years ago about somebody's personal life or might have even been kind of at a dog whistle level issues are not issues anymore. You know, I mean, like the de Blasio family has a really unusual story to tell. And
the lesbian.
Yeah, his wife was basically, I mean, I hope I have this right. You as a New Yorker would have a better grasp of it. But I think she's kind of says he's her first guy, really.
Yeah, she had an article in Ebony, I believe, in the 70s or 80s that said the title was I Am a Lesbian.
Mm-hmm.
So go Bill. I mean, that's...
Yeah, so he converted her, apparently, and then they're an interracial couple with this kid with an afro who just turned out to be the star of the campaign commercials
Absolutely.
And stuff like that. It was so the sort of the model of happiness and family happiness and stuff like that that really worked in New York is maybe a model that wouldn't work still in certain other parts of America and might not have worked before.
I just want to go very quickly back to the question you posed to me earlier about... We thought that we had left all these things behind after the Monica Lewinsky scandal.
Yeah.
Maybe we just have entered into a different era simply because of the existence of social media.
I think so, too.
Yeah.
I think that's the principal difference. That scandal, you know, because after all, the Lewinsky scandal would never have been known had it not been for the Ken Starr investigation on the other thing.
Right.
So I think that the social media aspect of it is fundamental. The texting, the Twitter,
well, it can
and
catch
so
fire speeds. Much more quickly.
Yes.
and kind of burn out of.
But
hand.
I think that by what the social media has done, it's not only simply that facilitate exposing these things, but also it has created a particular kind of outlet for some of these individuals.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, for example, Filner. One of the things I was reading, I don't know, I don't remember reading this ever. His fiance broke up with him because of excessive sexting.
Mm.
And so there's a certain
what is excessive and what is considered moderate?
Yeah.
For
just
sexting.
A little bit of sexting is okay.
Yes.
Yeah. So is that like we have to talk?
Yeah.
You know, it's not you.
Well, yeah, and I think some of it also is because of digital culture, things turn into memes and become. I mean, you know, Weiner had sort of slipped past his first set of problems. But Carlo's Danger is such an easily transferable and circulatable meme that, you know, I mean, you could just do so much with it. I mean, that might have been. But I also want to talk before we run out of time, particularly because we have a New Yorker here in our midst, too, about New York itself. And, it's an odd concatenation for me because I was just in New York for the first time recently and I haven't spent, not for the first time ever, but the first time in a long time. I really had time to really walk around New York. Hadn't done it for a while. Been traveling other places. Walked to some places that I hadn't been in a while. Walked to Astor Place, which I used to love so much. And there are all these glass towers like everywhere.
And where are the skateboarders? They're gone.
Yeah, like the whole, you know, and you walk towards certain things that you remember and liked because of their scruffiness. And this, and really a lot of places you look. I mean, I used to spend... one of my friends lives over in Chelsea and, you know, used to walk up and down. There were all these, you know... gay clubs with names I can't even say on the radio.
Chelsea Hotel was sold, I believe, right? To some bigger chain?
I thought it was still privately held, but it may have been sold. But,
I thought it was condos.
Maybe that's it, yeah.
But you walk around New York, and it, I mean, the High Line has completely transformed Chelsea.
Right.
And I sort of wonder, well, you said you want to talk a little bit anyway about what's sort of happening to the middle class in New York. I mean, every generation says, all right, that's the last of it. That's the last time New York will ever be any good. But
yeah.
I don't know. I almost find myself believing that.
I do, too. I think Manhattan is gone. When I first moved to New York City, I lived in the Village. I lived on Cornelia Street between Bleecker and West 4th. Mm. Bleecker Street Records is still there, and that's about it. And I'm sure when I got there in the 90s, it had changed tremendously. And We used to say, Giuliani's ruined the city, and we had all these anti-dancing laws like it was Footloose or something. And we thought it was the, you know, we thought this is it. It's turning into a strip mall. Where do we go? And so we went to Brooklyn where we could afford the rent. And now the same is happening to Brooklyn.
Right, right.
But, you know, we're pretty much established. And it's good and bad. Scruffy's great, but you can – it's romanticized scruffy too because – it's nice not getting mugged.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of nice. People still do get mugged, but it's nice not having it happen all the time.
And you can always watch Taxi Driver for nostalgia.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. There was a crack. Crack was crazy in New York City at one time.
Mm-hmm.
And that is not necessarily a good thing. As romantic as us transplants can make it, it's not good. There's people that are native New Yorkers that think the city is much better off the way it is now.
Yeah, Luis, I saw you nodding.
Yes, because I can only speak for, well, I mean, I went to New York a couple of times in the 80s, so my sense of New York is since 1990 when I came to Connecticut and started visiting family there and the city. And I don't have that nostalgia for the kinds of things that you're describing. Every part of the city, I'm enjoying it the way it is. I don't like gentrification. That's one place where I do draw the line.
It's the casualties of gentrification.
It's a gentrification in terms of the, you know, removal of people for certain neighborhoods, but that the city looks better. Why would I feel bad about that? I want to see if I can get into the psychology. If we can probe deeper into why scruffiness is something that you should feel nostalgic for. What's in it?
If you've been to CBGB's,
yes.
That might answer your...
And there's no more Beacon in a different place.
It's basically the notion, essentially, tell me if I'm wrong, it's basically the notion that it was more authentic.
Maybe. I mean, but real things happened at CBGB's. And then there was, you know...
Exciting
things happened. The men's room, too. So it should be closed just based on those things. But think about it. A whole movement happened in a few buildings in the 80s. Whether there wouldn't be a Talking Heads or a television or any of those bands, if it wasn't for that particular building and the owner.
And that could be said of art, music, theater, you know, everything in New York City. And that is just not Manhattan anymore.
Right.
I don't believe that's Manhattan
anymore. But
maybe
it's Brooklyn.
It is, and I think it's going to wind up being the Bronx and Queens. It's going to be there.
Right.
It's just not going to be where it was before. I mean,
but even where people used to – I'm so old. I remember when people fled to Brooklyn Heights because Manhattan was getting too expensive. Well, I mean,
a lot
of these places are prohibitively expensive. The places in Brooklyn you used to go to get away from the upward economic pressure in Manhattan are now prohibitively expensive for bohemians.
According to the New York Times, Brooklyn is basically almost gone, and so – at least a lot of it. So now the new frontier is Queens.
Yeah, hipster culture is moving into Queens.
Queens is where things are happening now. But at the same time, the New York Times also said in another article I read a few months ago, why is the Bronx out of limits to this process so far? You know, this is not happening there. Transportation.
I think it's transportation. I do.
There's Bronxville. That's different.
I think it's
that's
transportation.
Different.
And the South Bronx, the proximity, there's not as much infrastructure there that's amenable to people moving in.
But I do think that one place that is amenable is Harlem
yes.
and 125th Street.
It's already been gentrified.
Yeah, 125th Street, that whole area has now been gentrified in a way that would have been unthinkable even 10 years ago.
Right.
And you just sort of wonder, my theory about this is it's good for Hartford because, first of all, eventually all the bohemians, all the really interesting people who used to live in New York City will not be able to afford to live even in any outlying boroughs anymore. And not only that, but a lot of the funky, interesting, exciting people in Hartford won't be able to move to New York City the way they typically do once they possibly can. You know, the next Melanie the next Melanie Quintana just will have to stay in South Windsor.
Yeah.
And so we'll get her here in Hartford. And so, I mean, it could be ultimately that cool, you know, the real sort of low-budget, exciting, edgy, young version of cool will be so hard to afford in New York City that it'll help other
changed.
Places. Yeah.
Cool has changed. There used to be a show on HBO called How to Make It in America.
Yeah.
I love that show. I felt like that was watching home movies of my first years in New York, that kind of scrappy.
That was a fashion
That was the fashion show. But it was the spirit. It was that scrappy, on the hustle, trying to make something happen.
Yeah,
follow
it was almost
dreams.
More guys in the garment business than fashion. Yeah.
It was. I thought, seriously, it could have been my diary. I love that show. And that got canceled, and they replaced it with girls.
Mm-hmm.
Girls that have their cell phone bills paid by their parents.
Younger demo, too.
Yeah, and they seem to have all this time to sit around and talk and think about things.
Mm-hmm.
And when I moved to New York, we didn't have time to just hang out. Like, there wasn't that kind of hang out kind of. I feel like it has gotten a little soft. There is a little bit of absence of scrappy going on there. I'm sure it's there, but.
Well, you know, one of the fundamental questions about girls, we're going to have to go to break here, but girls asks, I think, part of the question we're asking right now, which is the things that girls looks at, culture in certain parts of Brooklyn and the Lower East Side, you know, are those things sort of cool and scrappy and exciting and bohemian, or is this a generation that's taking a long time to grow up, and this is just kind of a holding tank for them until they actually sort of figure out what they're going to do with their lives. We do have to take a little break. We want to get back to some of our other topics as well. So we'll be back with the nose after this.
No place in the world that can compare. Put your lighters in the air, everybody say yeah, yeah. Come on, yeah, yeah. In New York, come we come with dreams of fate. There's nothing you can do. Count your New York. These streets will make you feel brand new. Big lights will inspire you. Let's hear it.
All right, we're back with the nose. Let me tell you who's here. Melanie Cantaya is here. She's an actor and writer living in Brooklyn. She's going to be with The Mouth tonight, 7:30, Mark Twain House. This is a storytelling session hosted by our own Kyone Wolfe. $5 gets you in there. Also, you should pick up or order or somehow or other acquire Actor, Writer, Whatever, which is Melanie's book of essays, subtitled
Essays on My Rise to the Top of the Bottom of the Entertainment Industry.
All right. Also with us, Jim Chapdelain. Doesn't have a book out, but he's probably playing guitar on a CD very near you or producing it or something. Luis Figueroa is here with us. He's going to be DJing, actually, on Saturday night. But the rest of the time, he's a professor at Trinity College. So that's who's here. We're going to switch topics here a little bit. And the segue for this, actually, is the really interesting New York Times Sunday Magazine cover story last week about popularity and like what people actually know about, what things are kind of quote unquote popular and what that even means, which pointed out, and I guess HBO has been contesting this, that Girls actually is watched by 635,000 people, which is really not very much. Well, Breaking Bad is watched by more people, but not that many more people. But still, it sort of seems like everybody you know is watching Breaking Bad. They have a terrific character there named Saul Goodman. He's a lawyer. He's funny. He's played by Bob Odenkirk, who's a very funny comedian. And there's now going to be, apparently, a spinoff called Better Call Saul, which is his advertising slogan. And I think there's something about that idea, and we all are crazy about Saul these days. I mean, he gets funnier and funnier. Last week, he called over his shoulder to a teenage boy who had met him and was very excited because he loved his commercials. As he left, he said, "Don't drink and drive, but if you do, call me," which is a very sort of Saul kind of throwaway. So, but I think you were the one who said, maybe things should just end, you know? Maybe instead of spinoffs.
I'd have to credit that to the Scahill.
Right.
But I largely would agree with that. Otherwise, it seems to me that you're into like fan fiction and that whole weird subgenre. But I guess there's some characters that are so endearing that they would have to live on forever. I mean, the professor from Gilligan's Island comes to mind.
There was
immediately.
No professor spinoff.
Yeah.
Let's be clear about that.
Yeah.
There was no Gilligan's Island spinoff. There should have been.
You know,
but there aren't that many
spinoffs,
actually, right? Yeah.
Yeah. And they're making it a prequel, which I think is a device that could work better than continuing on after Breaking Bad ends. But
the hard thing about that is now he has to, like, wear young makeup or something like that?
Yeah, he will play himself as a younger man. Let me just say also, we won't have a lot of time for this topic, but to whatever extent we do, we'd love to hear from you. 860-275-7266. Leave the show as it is or squeeze a little bit more out of it, those of you who love Breaking Bad with this sequel. 860-275-7266. Melanie, I think you were sort of saying, well, there have been some good sequels, and then you could only think of two, right?
Yeah, it was Mork and Mindy. And now I forget the other
one. The Jeffersons was your
The Jeffersons yeah. was a good
spin-off.
Spin-off. Right, but
Well, when I came to the States in the 80s, there was a show, excuse me, called Benson, which
Benson
was a spin-off.
Yeah.
Wasn't
from
it?
Soap. Spin-off from Soap.
Right.
I can't believe I remember that.
Yes, and it was a very good show. I mean, at least for me, it made me laugh as I continued to learn the language. So there are a few cases where
Frasier worked,
exactly. So my ambivalent with this topic is that I have never seen Breaking Bad.
Rhoda.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Rhoda, yeah.
Oh, Rhoda.
So
I love Rhoda.
I'm probably one of 15 people in the entire country who has not seen Breaking
Bad.
No,
you're not. I mean,
that
goes back to the popularity issue. Things that everybody has seen, quote unquote, everybody has seen, it turns out a tiny fragment of the population has seen. So, but I would say one thing, and I'll direct this to Melanie because my guess is she has seen Breaking Bad. We are in kind of a different era of television, and there's this way in which a lot of the new HBO shows, the new Showtime shows, the new AMC shows push some of the limits of what's possible on television, really get us to kind of question a lot of our ideas about television conventions too, you know, sort of what kind of tropes are acceptable, what can sort of be, maybe even be destroyed or exploded somehow. And, you know, as successful as a show like Frasier was, or even to pick something that is close maybe, Buffy the Vampire Slayer led to Angel. Was it Angel a spinoff from Buffy?
Yeah. I think so, yeah.
So,
yes, it was.
Yeah, so, you know, it can be sort of done, but it seems like in this era of television, I'm wondering whether you can do something like that. I mean, particularly because Saul is comic relief in what is an incredibly dark and violent series.
I don't know. I'm very curious. I think going with a prequel was a good idea.
Yeah. You're hoping to be cast in this, aren't you? You don't have a clean conscience.
It's real. Potential employers, guys. I think it could be possible. I'm a little worried for it. Yeah. I'm a little worried for it for the exact reason you said. It is comic relief. Mm-hmm. He's very much in the Walter White world.
Yeah.
And I don't know.
He's the only relief we get from this incredibly bleak vision of violence, meth production, you know.
And just, his cronies as well.
He and his cronies.
He is a very funny guy, Bob.
Yeah,
is.
But he is.
Can I turn this at just a slightly different angle? In other words, okay, so he's the character, he's the actor, this is the character. But what about the producers, the people writing originally Breaking Bad? Mm-hmm. Because I was trying to catch up a little bit on doing some reading on Breaking Bad, and I realized, well, they had a concept for Breaking Bad where the protagonist would be an antagonist, and the storytelling would be different. Mm-hmm. So isn't their effort to create this new spin-off with that particular character like a challenge that they see themselves, that they need to get into something completely different? This time it would be a comedy show in a way, a farcical kind of show. So is that something that writers, your writer, going at a certain point you feel that you need to break into a new genre?
They're gonna turn it over to one of their writers too. And Melanie is either gonna be up there for auditions or trying to become a writer on the show. I'm not sure.
And what's funnier than
that?
What could be funnier than having a meth lab?
Right, but I don't know if they're gonna. You know, Breaking Bad is this continuous story. Mm. With Better Call Saul, it seems like the device would probably go in the way of Serial, where it's a beginning, middle, and end within a 1 hour show.
The example that I came up that would be the most fatalistic for the hopes of Better Call Saul. I spent a little time sort of looking at the history of spinoffs. Now I'm blocking the name of it. The Lone Gunman, which was the Lone Gunman were these three guys who interrupted the incredibly bleak world of Fox, Mulder, and Scully.
Right.
Remember, they were these three guys who would show up on the X-Files and kind of.
They were always in this cavernous sort of.
Right.
Thing lit
they
by
were,
the
they were almost this kind of Shakespearean trio of fools, you know, who once again would sort of lighten things up a little bit on the X-Files. They were given their own series that I think lasted about six episodes. It just didn't work at all because, I mean, once again, they were comic relief in an environment of darkness. You couldn't take them seriously, nor did you want that much comedy. So that would be the sort of worst possible fate for
It's also a completely different audience that they would be speaking to, right?
Yes.
I would think.
Now I'm going to jerk the wheel of the nose really hard and just turn us in a completely different direction. Vladimir Putin took to the pages of the op-ed page of the New York Times this week to lecture us, and to lecture us maybe even in a way that we needed to be lectured to, at least according to the way some people reacted to it. But I have to say that I actually get the physical New York Times delivered to my house, so I picked it up in my old man arms. let's see what's in the paper today. And I thought, wow, they gave space to Putin. I mean, that itself is a decision, right? I mean, here's this guy who really has not really been a force for good in the world. I think it's fair to say, whether you're from Georgia, or whether you're in Chechnya, or whether you're in Pussy Riot, no matter what, you probably don't think that Vladimir Putin is like a really great guy. And it's sort of like, wow, you know, they just gave him the space. On the other hand, the piece was kind of interesting. I don't know. Anybody want to react to that?
The piece, I think, was excellent,
yeah.
To be honest with you. It basically condenses a lot of the perspective that people have had about the United States around the world. And even also among some dissidents in the United States, and regarding foreign policy for the past decade or more. So in that sense, I was really shocked how well written it was. Not on just
do you think he wrote it?
No.
Yeah,
but But whomever wrote this has to have the qualifications to know very well the United States and its culture. What are the codes, what are the phrases, the discourses that would strike a chord among certain people in the United States and the world, but also has to have a certain amount of knowledge of foreign policy from a certain angle that would attract many people. Because the New York Times, this op-ed would be read by many people around the world, not only in English in the United States. And so when I read it, I was thinking, okay, how would this resonate with other people? And I would say tremendously. From top to bottom. And the bottom part about American exceptionalism drove me, actually, after I saw it, to construct a new exercise in one of my classes for the next couple of weeks that has to do with American exceptionalism. And so I asked the students about, okay, let's see what we know about American exceptionalism so I can finish putting together the exercise. And we should not assume that most people understand or know what American exceptionalism is.
I think that's right. And I think, by the way, if you want to call in about this, 860-275-7266, 860-275-7266. I think that this is useful. And it's come up a lot this week. And I was on Where We Live this week, and we had a professor from UConn kind of making the same point that we shouldn't assume that the rest of the world looks at us the way that we think of ourselves. And I think the rest of the world often looks at us and goes, well, you guys invade countries without UN sanctions, countries that are not threatening you. You run your own gulag. It's called Guantanamo. You torture people. You hold them without trial. You're not the good guys.
Do spin-offs.
Spin-offs, exactly. that's wrong. We know that.
Carlos Danger.
So I don't know. I mean, I ultimately didn't have a problem with Putin writing, but I don't know. Anybody else want to sort of chime in here?
My thought about all this is I don't have a problem with it either. But to me, and this is the first time I've bought into a conspiracy theory of my own making, is I think this is all political theater. I don't think that there was ever going to be a strike on Syria. I think this was all orchestrated at the G20 summit and to drive Assad into Putin's waiting shirtless embrace. and that a lot of this is kabuki, and that's just one part of it. That's just an act. I mean, I could be way off base, but that's how I'm choosing to look at my exceptional view on this, my American exceptional view.
And I think it's really important for us as Americans to know what people think of us.
Mm-hmm.
And I think as an act of journalism, it is entirely appropriate to have a world leader, whether they are our ally or not, to have a voice and communicate with us. That is what diplomacy is all of us communicating together. So I don't have a problem with the Times printing it at all.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I didn't either, although I was looking at it, and just the way my mind works, I started like going down the ladder of acceptability. I was trying to figure out whose op-ed they just wouldn't print, you know? Like if Assad wanted to write an op-ed, you know?
Probably
like this is how I see it.
Yeah.
And, right. And maybe it makes sense. I mean, really, an op-ed page is supposed to be kind of a free-floating forum for all kinds of different opinions, and they don't necessarily, you know, receive the blessings of the New York Times, except insofar as they're printed, but they're not endorsed by the New York
Kim
Times.
Kim Jong-un is getting a sports column on basketball.
Excellent. Yeah.
But, I mean, the whole narrative structure from the summer onwards, excuse me, for this Syria situation is really bizarre. Mm. Because to begin with, the Obama administration made a terrible mistake of painting itself in a corner from the beginning, calling on Assad to resign before people knew anything about how it was going. Okay, dictator, well, but there's a lot of dictators that the United States supports anyway. So the second one was the red line about the chemical weapons and so on. You're painting yourself in a corner. So now what do you do? And then saying, oh, telegraphing for weeks and weeks. I don't remember ever the United States or any country in my adult memory saying, oh, we are going to attack this country for weeks and weeks and weeks. And
how long did
we'll
the run-up to Iraq last?
Well, shock and awe. Iraq had a long
run. Yeah, shock and awe. It's going to be over in a few days, and we're going to be greeted as liberators.
Yes, well, my memory then is beginning to falter as I get older.
Just wait.
Yes.
Actually, finish up, and then we're
going to... No, just was going to finish really quickly, is that now the John Kerry coming up with this idea of turning over all these... whole week
sarcastically
as a joke, and then this my safe peace in the Middle East. The whole thing is absolutely bizarre.
I said this week I felt like I was watching a Pink Panther movie about the Cuban Missile Crisis. All right, we're going to take a quick break. We'll come back with everybody's endorsements.
A New York Times op-ed piece is one thing, but I really object to Putin being in a Super Bowl ad for Doritos. Also, snack shirtless is a really stupid slogan. Today's show was produced by Patrick Scahill, Betsy Kaplan, and me, with help from our interns, Corey Breen and Greg Dyson. The part of Bill Curry was played by Bob Packwood. On Monday, the very model of a Gilbert and Sullivan show. And now, back to Colin.
Another thing he could do, he could take over as the most interesting man in the world, right?
Yes.
Stay thirsty, my friends.
Yes.
All right, so it's time to do endorsements. This is where our panel tells you about some things that they know about that you might enjoy knowing about, too, and that might enrich your life. We'll start over here with Jim Chapdelaine.
Okay, for food, food to go. There's this great place in Cromwell called La Piastra, and they've been winning all kinds of awards. They're off exit 19 of 91. I've stopped by and picked up a few things. It's really great. And
what is the type of cuisine we're talking about?
I would say broadly Italian, but everything,
yeah.
a lot of stuff, and fresh and handmade right on the spot. Mm-hmm. And then you pick up your container. You can pre-order. You can, and it's really excellent.
Does one eat in there too, or is it merely?
No, it's just to go.
Just to go.
And La Piastra meaning the plate. That's all you need. Is the theory. The other thing, I'm going to, since we're talking about prequels, I'm pre-endorsing something I haven't seen. So there's this great movie coming out. I've seen the trailers. I've been reading about it. I'm very excited about it, called Tim's Vermeer, that Penn and Teller are producing, about Johannes Vermeer's painting technique. And it's thought for a while that he might have used a camera obscura to capture everything so accurately, and so they explore a variety of ways with this eccentric millionaire who decides it's a mirror and projects the image, and we'll see.
I think I can announce also that Penn Jillette will be at the Mark Twain House on stage being interviewed by me on Halloween night.
Wow.
So that'll be fun, too. So okay. You can maybe combine those things.
Lastly, I've been asked to say that the Vontons at Art Street tonight and the Shinola's Monday at the main pub in Manchester.
Rock and roll.
And I'm done.
All right. Melanie, what have you got for us?
I've got, of course, the Mark Twain House tonight, The Mouth. Kyone is hosting. Stories of Luck and Serendipity. I will also be there. And this weekend, I'm going to try and check out The Neighbor to the Mark Twain House, the Harriet Beecher Stowe House, which I hear is doing some great programming on social justice issues, and I can't wait to check that out. And
you can plug your book one more time.
Oh, sure. Actor, writer, whatever, essays on my rise to the top of the bottom of the entertainment industry. Maybe I have a wobbly table leg. At the very least.
That's not part of the subtitle, however. Right. All right. Go ahead, Luis.
So the first one is I suffer from terrible chronic back problems, pains for almost 30 years. And I'm so delighted to say that I found someone who's expert care. The place is called Nurturing Hands for Massage, especially a deep massage technique. And her name is Kelly Rice. Terrific. And I really strongly recommend it. It's made a big difference in the last couple of weeks in my health.
Is that in West Hartford?
It's in West Hartford. And it's on Farmington Avenue, 777 Farmington Avenue, near the Cosmos South Asian store. And the second one, my Evernote failed me today because I wrote the name of the band and I can't find it now. But there is a Latin jazz band that plays at the Firebox.
That's Ed Fast's Congo Bop.
That's the name. Fantastic. 8-piece Latin jazz band that features up front an electric guitar fellow who is really good. I mean, all of them are great. But as someone who knows a little bit about this kind of music, I'll tell you that it's not very common to run into a setup like these people. They are really terrific. Someone told me that they are there once a week, maybe Wednesdays or something like that.
I think that might be right, yes. Ed Fast, who's a percussionist. Actually, he's also with the Hartford Symphony. But, yeah, he has a band called
I strongly
Conga.
Recommend them. They're absolutely great. The only problem is that there's no space to dance. That's right. My only criticism.
Conga Bop is the name of that band. I was able to complete that thought of yours, plus where Benson came from. So I feel good today.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah, no, because my own brain is not working that well on my own behalf. So I'm so excited that it's working well on behalf of you. All right, so I'm going to endorse the actress Paula Malcolmson, who is probably not really exactly a superstar, but if you've seen her in anything, chances, and she's been around forever. She's actually Irish. I believe she's from Belfast. She's currently in Ray Donovan on Showtime, which she's Ray Donovan's wife. Ray Donovan did not get very good reviews, and so I didn't watch it at first, and I am now catching up with that. I'm completely enthralled.
I am too, and it takes a while to get to buy in.
Yeah, she's marvelous in everything that I've ever seen her in, and this allows me to tie in the concept of a spinoff / prequel, and that is Caprica. Caprica was the attempt by Battlestar Galactica to show something that was the prequel to all the events that unfold in Battlestar Galactica. It was it died on the vine. I think it's fair to say it didn't do very well, although I actually thought it was pretty good, and it had a fabulous cast. I mean, like, everybody in it was great. She played the disaffected wife of Eric Stoltz. And she was marvelous in that. In Ray Donovan, she's kind of a little bit of a Carmela Soprano knockoff in the sense that she is from Southie. She's a Boston girl, working class Irish American Boston girl who's stepped into this world of opulence thanks to her violent fixer husband. And
I just want to know how can they drink that much and have any sort of life?
Right. And so the aspirational part of all that, she just. Nails really well. But everything that I've ever seen her in, she's in The Hunger Games too. She's in all kinds of things. And she's an overlooked actress, but that's probably good. You know, she's not a superstar, but she's just great in everything that I see her in and has a very special allure as well. So that's my main endorsement. Since I have a few extra seconds here, let me just mention that on October 2nd, we're moving the show that evening to the Watkinson School. As some of you know, I host a series there called Freshly Squeezed. We've got, I think, what is going to be a really interesting show. We're going to do a show on the notion of ethical consumerism, about how all of us, or so many of us, try to marry our consumer beliefs, our ideological beliefs about animal rights or the environment or labor to our consumer behavior. So we have Bun Lai, who runs the most sustainable sushi restaurant in America. I'm absolutely confident of that. Barry Nelbuff, the founder of Honest Tea, will be joining us, and a bunch of other guests as well. We're really going to kind of try to pull this apart and kind of examine whether ethical consumerism really works, too. How much of a difference does it make if you're out there trying to buy certain products and stuff like that? So stay tuned for more details, but you're invited to come. If you get on Watkinson.org, I think that's their site, the Watkinson School, you can find out more about how to get tickets. Tickets are very inexpensive, and all the profits go to the Hartford Stage and Billings Forge and I think the Mark Twain House, actually. So it's all good. We'll be back tomorrow. We'll be back Monday. My brain's working just fine, really. Meanwhile, go see The Mouth tonight. at the Mark Twain House.
Vernon, I already said that one. Avon, Farmington. Yeah.
You on the radio.
On the radio, baby. You and me talking rapping now.
I'm Kyone Wolf, and I knew we would be able to make it through an entire episode on Friday the 13th with no problem.